Combat Zone Wrestling returns to the Flyers Skate Zone in Voorhees, New Jersey on Saturday, May the 10th at 7:30 p.m. with Proving Grounds live on CZWIPPV.com, featuring the debut of Shelly Martinez and the final death match of Dysfunction when he faces the deathmatch drunkard Danny Havoc. For tickets and complete information, please visit CZWrestling.com. Combat Zone Wrestling, it's like nothing else.
Hey everybody, it's Nate Steiner with KJ. And
hey guys.
And the CZW Wire Television Champion, Mr. Shane Strickland.
Hello.
I don't know what I did, Strickland.
Yeah.
I'm not south of the Mason-Dixon line here in New Jersey.
Some Memphis, Tennessee sound and music over here. Like melodies.
So I'm gonna really quickly say I'm an idiot.
Yes.
We actually recorded an interview.
An entire interview.
And
pretty much start to finish. We're close to done.
The sound wasn't quite.
He forgot to hit record.
I hit record. You have to hit record twice. And I'm
exhausted already.
We're gonna disown him later.
I'm so sorry.
So I'm pretty much doing a best of the best of
the
interview.
Yeah.
So now I'm going to like, oh, I got to do another one? All right.
We're going to do the highlight. So you're going to get the best of the best of Shane Strickland at best of the best. See? It's a whole...
But I'm so tired. Oh, I don't feel like talking anymore.
Okay, well, everybody...
I'm a diva myself out. Just like, oh, no.
I almost actually started saying names.
Let's not piss anyone
fantastic.
Off.
Fantastic. Fantastic.
So we were having a conversation about the craziest fan experiences.
Oh,
and
yeah.
And we started, again.
Speaking of putting names out there, we started with Chrissy Rivera. So.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Let me go back in that.
Because
I do
want to
touch on that.
What was
the
craziest fan experience?
Yes. Yeah.
Craziest fan experience. I do want to touch a bit on, like, yeah, the Chrissy Rivera thing is just really funny because, like I never really had crazy fan experiences except, like, Facebook crazy messages. And I touched on the fact, like, I'm not a jerk like Chrissy Rivera is who, like, takes, like, whoever sent her something obnoxiously insane.
Right.
And she just posted on Twitter and Facebook, right. Tag name. Now over here is just, like, oh, dick pic guy now. So so now, yeah. Oh, I didn't want to.
The non.
Yeah, default job.
Yeah.
So now, like.
For MySpace picture.
Yeah, yeah. Like this guy. So now, like, I'm not going to use Josh Williams.
Ah, there you go.
Josh Williams can't go to freaking Dunkin' Donuts to get a latte anymore because, like, hey, dick pic guy. Yeah, you? Yeah, we remember you. Oh, now he's like, no, my life is ruined because Chrissy Rivera.
He wanted was for her to appreciate it.
I just appreciate my penis picture that I sent it to you as a trophy of my appreciation, but now I'm dick pic guy for the rest of my life until Facebook ends.
Right.
But anyway, personally, my fan, it's not even a fan, it's just a good wrestling story.
Okay.
Because everybody needs one.
Yes.
And this is, like, really enjoyable because it was just, like, my first long trip. So.
Where were you?
I was in Ybor City, Florida. And Ybor City is just a weird town. That strip alone is just, like, there's, first off, it was a Sunday show that we did, and we're walking down the street, and it's packed. It's like a New Orleans type of street, mm-hmm. Bourbon Street type place, and there's people walking around in, like, bunny costumes, pink bunny costumes, so you think you're high automatically. I'm like, whoa, what's going on here? So then you keep walking, there's transsexuals walking by, and I'm like, okay, so you think you're high again, and so you're like, whoa, what's going on here?
Where were the people in the pink bunny costumes going?
I don't know.
Okay.
People are just walking.
Clearly there's a pink bunny
I wonder about things like that. I'm like, where would this guy be going with this?
It's the furries.
Where was he coming from? And where is he going? What does he plan to do with these costumes? But it was like three or four guys like that.
Okay.
And then, like, there's like a 16 and under club right next door to, like, an 18 and over club. So, like if they just accidentally walk into the wrong clubs, there could be some really, really illegal stuff going on. I'm like, oh my god, this is going to be bad.
Yeah.
So
very bad.
So it's just a weird, like, strip
in
a weird town.
17-year-olds go anywhere? That's what I want to know.
Yep.
But
17-year-olds
no,
not welcome.
Right.
No, I got to stay home and send dick pics to Chrissy Rivera. So I'm with like Trent Beretta, and it's John Silver, and it's Papadon, and there's some other guys too. But like we're just walking up there because there's a really, really, really good pizza restaurant that's up the street that Trent knows. He's like, oh, come on, let's go. So we're walking, I'm following him, and like I'm kind of like on my phone. They're walking beside me. I feel them, but I don't necessarily know what they're doing. I just like know they're here somewhere.
Yeah.
And you know, when you walk with a group of people, they're just kind of like just ambiances of people. So like I'm walking, and we're going up the street, and there's craziness going on. But Trent recognizes one guy that's just like an outside like bar setting.
Yeah.
He's just sitting there, like on a lawn chair, just like being just sitting there, like being like. Just like feel like he's feeling himself a bit too much. I'm like, okay. So he walks up to me. He's like, hey, there he is. He walks up to him. He's like, hey, guy, how's it going? And he puts his fist out to fist bump with him. But the guy's like, no, I'm okay. I'm like, okay, this guy's clearly homosexual. But like, I don't have a problem with homosexual people. I just could clearly tell this man is a homosexual person.
I just realized now, really quick, when you said the story before, that it was Trent who put his fist out.
It was
out.
Trent. Because at this time, Trent was still under the contract deal.
Yeah.
And so he was living in Florida at the time.
Okay.
So he's just like, he sees him before. He's seen him several other times. So he's like, hey, there he is, and runs up to him and puts his fist up. He's like, no. And so like he's like, okay. So he puts his foot up at him. I got to adjust the camera again. He puts his foot at him like this, like at his face, like maybe a foot away from his face. And the guy just goes, and just licks the bottom of his shoe all the way to the top of the toe. Heel to toe, just sensual, just like enjoying it, every second of it.
Okay,
and
okay.
He's just like, oh. And then I'm like, what? Whoa! And then John Silver goes, wait, do me too. And he puts his foot up. And then he just goes, it licks the bottom of his shoe.
So
again.
When he just Trent, it was like
it was both of them. It was Silver and Trent got their feet licked.
Did he make the noise? He made
that noise.
That's almost part like the worst.
No, that he made the noise, and I wouldn't be surprised if slobber dripped from their shoe after that. But anyway, like I'll just they run off. They're like laughing and like high fiving each other up the street. Like they just like just did something amazing. I'm like, I saw us catch up. I'm like, what the hell is that? And he's like, oh, you don't know him? No! He's like, that's the Tampa Bay shoe licker. What is that? What is a Tampa Bay shoe licker? He's like, oh, he's a homeless guy that has this big shoe fetish. He's gay, too. I'm like, did you just let that walk around here? Like, what is going on? So I went home, and I freaking, later on the trip when we were driving back up, I got on my phone and looked him up. And apparently on Facebook, he is the Tampa Bay shoe licker.
He has a Facebook page.
He has a Facebook page, the Tampa Bay Shoe Licker.
It's titled
Tampa Bay
Shoe Licker.
Shoe Licker. All four words. Tampa Bay Shoe Licker. So
if he's homeless and he has a Facebook page.
I don't know how he's getting his.
Is he just like uploading things at the library? Because that's
I don't know, but the man, his status are hilarious. They're so funny because they're like little nursery rhymes, like Dr. Seuss nursery rhymes, but he puts shoes and like a sexual act of shoes in them, and it's just really funny. And then the people that comment on are really funny. You have problems. You're disgusting. Oh my God, who does that? Oh my God. And then he just comments back like, you're just mad because it's not your shoe. And I'm just like, this is the greatest thing ever. So fans, when you watch this, go home and find the Tampa Bay Shoe Licker on Facebook. You'll friend him, and he will accept it, and it'll just be a good time for like 5 minutes. Then you'll be like, this is disgusting, and you'll unfriend him and block him so he can never contact you again. This is great.
I'm going to do us all a favor and get off this topic as quick as possible, and let's get back to what we're supposed to be talking about, which is wrestling.
Yay, this thing
we heard the story
do.
Before, but because, you know, Nate can't push buttons properly.
He pushed my buttons.
How'd you get into wrestling, and then how'd you get brought into CCW?
Well,
thank you for bringing it around.
Yes.
Somebody had to be the responsible one here.
Well, like, I'll go way back to when I was a wee tad of a boy. Actually, I started watching professional wrestling around, like, 12 years old. And I remember the first full episode of SmackDown I ever watched all the way through was the Billy and Chuck wedding episode, and that always sticks out to my mind because that's just a significant Right. Like everybody's like, oh, I remember that, or like, oh, I remember exactly where I was when I watched that. So it's like, it was just it was a pretty like memorable point in like wrestling to remember that. But it wasn't that made me fall in love in wrestling. It was like Rey Mysterio in the Cruiserweight division, and Rey Mysterio was just like the guy in my like he was like. Like meeting us, like it was just like seeing a superhero live,
right?
And seeing what he was doing, that captivated me so much. And it was just something about him that just drew me in, and it, like that made me want to watch more and watch everybody else and watch wrestling all together. So it was Rey Mysterio, his character, and everything that he was doing in the ring at the time was just so amazing to me. So I started watching for like at 12, and then it's and around high school, around like the 10th grade. I moved up to another school in Lancaster, Pennsylvania, and I became friends with this one buddy. He was he had CZW tapes, and he was like, "Oh, you like wrestling?" All I watched at that time was just regular like WWE. What was on television? It was what I was watching.
Yeah.
So he started showing me like CZW tapes, and the first person he showed me was Ruckus, and I was like, and it was 300-pound Ruckus at this time. It was still doing the same stuff he does now. It was just incredible. And I was like, this guy's amazing. Oh, my God. This dude is ridiculous.
Super light. I mean, if you've never seen what I say is Fat Ruckus, light on his feet, flipping off, running up walls.
It was incredible. Like, to this day, it's still, like, the most amazing stuff. And you have Andrew Everett and guys like that doing stuff. Like, and I'm like, this is still crazy, insane. So that, like, drew me into CZW. Then I saw, like, Trent Acid. Then I saw Wingers. And I saw, I just saw, like, the division was just incredible. Like, oh my God, this is insane. And so I kind of like lost base with watching independent level wrestling for a while until like I started getting into training and becoming a professional wrestler. Mm-hmm. But I backyarded a little more in high school because we were idiots and like that was a
fit.
We were kids.
What was the stupidest thing that you did in backyard wrestling?
A light tube. Like, my buddy, we were in the grass. We didn't, like, a lot of people built rings. We didn't build a ring. We did it right on the grass because we were cheap and poor and broke. So we were like, yeah.
Did you have anything for ropes or just?
Nope. We ran into the wall, touched it, and ran back. That's the spring. That's all the spring we needed. But we were just doing it in the grass, and, like, we were big ECW, like, marks. And so we were just like, oh, we're going to call the company, like, Violent Wrestling Society. And, like, we'll never live up to that because we're not that insane. So
with like, our one light tube.
Yeah. And it wasn't the best thing about it is we didn't even, like, buy light tubes. Like, everybody's like, oh, we're going to bring in light tubes and tables and ladders. Like, no, we're walking down the street one day. There's a light tube. We're going to use it. And like, so this could have hepatitis on this light tube for all we know. But like, we're going to use it and we're going to cut ourselves with it and this is going to be amazing. I'm going to record it and nobody's going to watch it. So my buddy, like, we found a light tube like early in the week and we're like, all right, this Saturday we're going to freaking have a match. And so he ends up jumping off a ladder and putting the light tube under his leg and doing a leg drop to me and like landing on the light and it crushes, but it like his foot slices my arm. Like slices it, and the skin is like hanging off, like that much, like maybe like 3 inches of skin.
Asking for this story.
It's just hanging off my arm. I'm like, oh, this is awesome, because I'm an idiot at the time, and so like I wrapped up with a bandana and we continued wrestling, and like
just the bandana,
yeah, and the scar's still on my arm, and but that was like my first like big crazy moment in it. But, like, once again, like, it was a phase from some of my friends. But for me, I was like, I really love doing this. But it wasn't enough for me anymore. I was like, I want to actually do it. And then everybody's like, yeah, man, I'm thinking about doing it, too. But I don't think I'm going to do it. But I'm thinking about doing it, but I'm not. But, you know, I want to, but, you know. So I'm like, no, actually.
Start my sock drawer first.
Yeah, I'm just going to take these tapes and throw it in the back of my bed. Like, so I was like, no, I actually want to do this. So, like, my mom was living in Virginia at the time, Richmond, Virginia. And, I was going to plan on moving down there again in like a week or two. So I researched like wrestling companies and places I can get trained properly to do it. And I ended up finding a place. I called them. They were doing a show at the time. I was talking to the promoter himself and owner of the company. And he's just like, yeah, come on down. And so I moved down there on like a Sunday, I believe. And then that Tuesday, I went in and started getting trained. Like my mom drove me in. We signed a contract, and I started training that night. Took my first bumps that night.
How long ago was that?
That was in August of 2008. Okay.
See, was, I keep thinking when you say that, I'm
yeah,
like, it's like, I thought you've been here longer.
Like, oh, no, it was like 1999. No, it was like August of 2008 when I first started training. And I had my first match in March of 2009, so that following year. Yeah. So, but getting into CZW was like probably about a year and a half later than that. Little do people may know, I actually knew Phil Stamper around that time when I was training in Richmond, Virginia.
You mean Nate Stein?
Nate Stein.
Whatever.
Whatever.
Trust me.
Yeah. But I actually knew him back then, and he was actually still working for CZW, and he was like, he was like definitely the connection for me to make that way from the Mid-Atlantic region up north, because he introduced me to Greg Excellent in groundbreaking wrestling, and that's why I met Adam Cole. I met Adam Cole that night because he had a match with Joe Gacy when it was really amazing, a really good match. And I thought it was so good that, like, I met Adam, but I didn't really meet him. It's like he didn't know who I was. Yeah. But, like, probably later on that week, I just went on Facebook randomly and just messaged him. I was like, hey, man, I love your stuff, man. I'm really looking to do this. And I just sent him a long message. And I sent it. I never talked to him before. And after that, like, it was probably like a good month. Or some time. It was a good time before he got back to me about it. And I was just, and I was like, oh, this guy just, no, like, just, some guy just writing me, and he just threw away, like, the long message I sent him. I was like, oh, wow, I'm never going to hear from him again. Mm-hmm. But then, like, he comes back, and he's like, hey, man, I've read your stuff, and I watched your match, because I sent him a match I had with Alex Colon at that time. And he was just like, oh, man, I watched your match, and here's what I thought. And he sent me this long critique of everything. Like, he watched and he dissected it, and he really paid attention to it. I was like, wow, he actually, like, watched it. Right. And he just said, like, things that he likes, things that he didn't like, things that, like, could be better. And I was like, wow, he actually paid attention to it. And he was like, tell you what, man, you're really good, but you have a lot of potential. You can get a lot better. Like, you should definitely come up to CZW, and, like, I'm running training schools on these days. And I was like, oh, cool. So, like, it took me a while because I didn't have a car at the time. Mm-hmm. But I ended up driving up there and training with Adam and the rest of the students, and then DJ. I finally met with DJ, and my training, he gave me a training match, which they're never good. You're set up to fail because he gives you some trainee that's like knows absolutely nothing, and he has no athletic ability, and he's just a ball of mold of fat, and he's not agile, and he's just bleh. So that's why I wrestled some guy like that. And it wasn't good at all. And he just cut, like, and then DJ brings me up in front of the class, like, yeah, see, this is what he did wrong. And then this is why he's doing
greatest this. Greatest DJ impression ever.
He did this bad. And then, like, yeah, like, and then, like, so he smartens up. The students already smartened up about DJ's syllabus to the school. And
not
then,
you.
But not me. I this is my first time meeting him. Yeah. I don't know the CZW way. So, like, I'm just like, oh, wow, I know nothing. I'm slime. I'm awful. This is never going. So he's just like, just shit crapping on me all in front of his students, like, who I'm supposed to be better than, because I've been wrestling for like a year and a half, 2 years now. So now I'm like, oh, I am awful. And then
like
so.
Like an ego boost.
I'm like, oh. So now I'm down here. And so, like, and this is why we're still at the arena at the time. And he pulls me aside. He's like, you know what, Adam's talked up about you, you know, he said some good things about you, and I see a lot of potential in you, and you're really good. I just want you to come to the school, train, and come to the shows on the weekend. You know, I just want you to come by and, like, just learn, be around the guys, you know. I was like, thank you. This is just so, I, like, it came back. I was like, I started feeling good after I left, but I still felt bad because I hate having bad matches.
Yeah.
Regardless if it's in front of a crowd or in front of two people, I hate it. It's the worst feeling in the world to me, especially when it's in front of the owner of CZW.
Yeah.
And so I'm not going to get another chance forever. But then, like, those chances started coming more and more because I kept coming and I kept, like, doing more than what I was asked of. And DJ saw that. And so he started, like, whenever he needed, like, a helping hand or, like, somebody to fill a spot, he's like, it's Shane. I was like, cool. Because I was always there. I was always around DJ. I was in his car.
Yeah.
I was like, oh, I need to run and pick up my laundry. I'll go. And so I was just always there. I was always wanted to be around it because I just always wanted to show that I loved it. And I'm not just a guy passing through. I wanted to be a part of this.
Now, I know something that you and DJ have in common.
Uh-oh. Oh.
So that's a good lead, right?
Oh.
Should I be scared?
I got to get rid of it now.
Dragon Ball.
Yes.
See, it's a good, it's a good safe area.
Yeah. Okay. I was like, we do. I gotta stop. I gotta get rid of whatever it was. Now.
I'm a huge nerd, and this is where I just sit back and let them talk.
It's Dragon Ball. Like, what were you watching? Well, obviously, I'm gonna date myself here. I was gonna
Powerpuff Girls.
There you go, Powerpuff. Yeah. Thank you for the save. Because I'm totally gonna
say because I watched Powerpuff Girls. Don't doubt me.
Right. The Rowdy Rough Boys were cool.
Why was that only one episode?
They had two.
Where?
There was another one.
Oh, Lord.
Okay, we're going to get...
Forget the interview. I need to find this episode.
We're done here.
I need to find the Rowdy Rough Boys Part 2 episode. Jesus. Anyway, yeah.
So, Dragon Ball. Favorite Dragon Ball story?
My favorite one is the Majin Vegeta episode.
Okay.
Well, that series, actually, because that was just like... Vegeta was already my favorite character at the time. Even though when he was introduced, he was a bad guy with Goku. And then, like, he was always like, I'm going to kill you and I'm going to destroy the Earth. Then I love how his motives changed after a while. Like, I want to kill you, then I'm going to destroy the Earth. I'm going to go back to, like, Planet Vegeta, which is gone now, but he doesn't know that. And, like, I'm going to do all this. And, like... And then, like, later on, he's like, you know what, I'm going to kill you, then I'm going to go kill Frieza, then I'm going to wish the Dragon Balls, I'm going to become immortal, and I'll be the greatest being ever lived. And then it changed to, like, okay, Kakarot, Goku, I just want to beat you. And when he went Majin, he finally beat him. But then he still, like, everybody's like, oh, he beat him, so now he's going to go back to his old methods. But no, he's like, no, I'm going to sacrifice myself to save the greater good. And I always thought that was just really cool, like, see Vegeta finally move to his next level, because he struggled to get to Super Saiyan, and then he struggled to get here. Now he's like, okay, he got to another level. I always loved that series.
Okay. Yeah. And we also got into talking, like, why isn't there a black Super Saiyan?
And I'm convinced Oob is a black Super Saiyan.
That's Super Saiyan.
He is my black Super Saiyan. Okay. He is mine. Before that, it was Piccolo, and he died 7 times. So I'm like, okay, I can't deal with Piccolo. He does the job every series.
Yeah.
Can't do it. Oob is my man. So I started riding for Oob and GT. Oob. He's not even black. He's Indian. Now,
and I will say, in the Dragon Ball canon, GT is even a touchy subject. So, like, saying that Oob is, like, your favorite in that
universe.
Yes.
A universe inside of a Dragon Ball universe. Right. Yeah.
But at least we're not even going to touch on the Dragon Ball movie.
You stay out of this.
Like,
No.
That was the only movie I started to stand up and walk out of the theater, and if it wasn't for the live commentary people in the audience were doing, I would have left.
I'm mad you paid to see it. I watched it when it came on HBO. I was like, this is happening?
Yeah.
This guy? I was just like... No. Actually, I rented it. I remember this. I rented this, and I watched it, and I... I think I threw the disc out. I didn't think I returned it because I didn't want to affect the building that I wanted.
Right. Society needs to do it.
Like, you know, I'm going to do society a favor and kill this right now. Right. Pow. It's laying in the gutter of Richmond, Virginia somewhere now.
Have we destroyed your nerd sensibilities? Yeah. I'm just saying.
You just spoke gibberish for 5 minutes, so.
Yeah.
Dragon Ball.
Just like a DJ Hyde promo.
Oh!
You can't get rid of me now.
Oh, don't say that. No, hey,
sounds like a challenge.
Cause like that son of a sitting in his throne somewhere.
Remember that one light tube in the backyard? There's gonna be something else waiting for you.
Like, oh yeah, ladder match. Bring him out. It's just a freaking big pyramid of light tubes
wrapped in barbed wire.
Now look at him like, bring it on.
So, kind of going back to injuries, because you mentioned, you know,
right.
Arm open and now light tubes and barbed wire.
Yeah.
I remember we were in Dayton, Deja Vu.
Right.
You cut yourself open pretty bad.
Yeah.
He cut himself open.
Well, I didn't just sit there in the middle of the ring and go like this, like this is Sparta.
With the crocodile bloody knife.
This is a knife. No, it was actually the...
This is Sparta.
It was actually... it was the tag match. It was me and Aaron Fox against Andrew Everett and Alex Colon. Mm-hmm. And at the end, they got themselves disqualified by hitting me with the ladder. But they used the side of the ladder that had the hinge on it that opens and closes the ladder. That sliced me across the chest. And if you look, it's still, you can see it in pictures that I post on Facebook. It's still like,
if you can't see,
it's like about 6 inches long across my chest. From like the middle of my chest, like my chest cavity, all the way to like, almost my second ab, right here because I have abs. I do crunches. But all the way, it's about 6 inches long.
This is Harry.
They have names too, just numbers.
This is Jim. I was going to say this is Josh Williams, but he does dick pics. Can't have them on my ass.
Right.
So it ends up, so I end up getting cut pretty bad, and they end up, like, bringing me, thank God it was at the end of the match, because, like, I don't know, like, it was been everywhere if the match would have continued on. But I end up, just getting some, like, peroxide and some cleaning stuff on it. They bandaged it, and I had to ride home like this. Like, in, like, 10 hours, like, oh, my chest is bleeding. I can't, like, bend down to pick up stuff because it's just, like, it hurts.
Right.
But then we get to, like, I'd say the following weekend was the Down with the Sickness ladder match, and it was all four of us again in a four-way ladder match. So if you watch the match, like, Down with the Sickness 2013, you'll see me, like, checking on my chest the whole time, like, for the first half of it. And I was
making
like,
sure you're not bleeding.
Yeah, I'm like, oh my God. Like, and they're being jerks because they're chopping me. And I'm like, ah! It's only a week. It's literally 7 days after it happened. The same guys that did it to me, like, they're chopping me in the chest and, like, making sure I'm not all over the place.
Right.
So I'm like, just keep checking on it. You'll see that in the first half of the match. And then, like, later on, I'm like, oh, I have other injuries I got to worry about. So that's a little story. But that's, like, the only serious injury I've ever had. Other than that, like, I back when, like, my first year of wrestling, I was in Virginia. I was in a tag match, and my buddy, my partner, we did this maneuver where I charged him, and he tosses me over the top rope to the outside. I land on whoever, the two. He tosses me over, and, like, I just, like, kind of, like, overshot, and I just smacked the floor. And it's a gym hardwood floor. And I'm sweaty, and, like, I hit, my flesh hits, like, the hardwood, and it's just the loudest ever, like, in the whole gymnasium. And it's like the crowd is like, just goes, oh, in the silence for like take her Brock Lesnar silence for like 45 seconds. It was just like, oh. And then, you know, it's like the worst type of reaction in wrestling is no reaction. So when, like, fans are like, oh, they're like, oh, it just gets awkward. And so, like,
we feel obligated to do the, no, I'm still alive.
I wanted to pop up and go, like, nip up and be like, yes, I'm okay. But I wasn't. I was actually, like, pretty, like, I ended up bruising, like, my lower back. And, like, it went in, like, my ass, the top of my right ass cheek. And then, like, my hip. It was just all that was just, like, really badly bruised. And it was so, I ended up continuing the match and finishing it. And, like, and I got pinned. Of course, I'm the hurt guy. I got pinned, and we had to walk to the back. And, like, they rested me. They gave me, like, half of a Percocet. So I'm like, oh, man, I don't even take pills.
By a designated medical professional.
Sure. yeah, let's go with that. So, like, I ended up, like, taking a Percocet, and, like, they iced me, ice bag, like, and a heating pad on me. And I was just like, oh. It started feeling better, but then the next morning was the worst ever. And, it was just so bad. I remember Xavier Woods, it was on the show with us, and he's just looking at me like, yeah, that looks like it hurts, man. I'm like, yeah. Yeah, I'm in pain. Thank you, Creed. Anyway, moving on. It was just like, I remember, I was like, at that time, I wasn't wrestling every weekend. I didn't have this crazy schedule like I do now. So, like, my next show wasn't for, like, another month.
Yeah.
And so I just missed training for, like, 2 weeks. I still went, but I didn't train. I just sat there and watched and gave advice and got advice and stuff. And then, like, 2 weeks later, I got into feeling better, and I started training, and I wrestled again. But that was, like, the only time I was, like, I sustained an injury, per se.
Yeah. Sure.
But I get hurt, but right. I don't get injured.
What's worse, the impact or the next morning?
The next morning. Mm-hmm. Like, because an impact just feels kind of numb. Like,
yeah.
The struggle of getting up is just like a long, agonizing grind and whatever muscle or bone or
everything that's now been relaxed for 9 hours. You know?
Everything that you like, everything that was easy before is just like the hardest thing ever. Like,
right.
Oh man, stairs. Like,
right.
Oh,
just throw
oh the refrigerator. I'm so hungry. I can't open it. Just like everything that was easy and you take for granted all the time is just like 10 times harder.
I'm really trying not to make fun of you right now.
What?
Because of this.
Sorry.
So
refrigerator.
So,
and every time today as you go to reach for something, with that hand. What are you doing? Sorry.
I've had times like that. I'm like, Like, oh, like, sorry. Like, I'm in, walking in the backyard, you see a ball, you want to kick it, like, yep! Oh, my God! You're lying down, like, no! Oh, I forgot!
You just don't think about it, and you're like, oh, well, I have to open a door, let me open the door. Why am I doing it with my sprayed breast?
Yeah, like, yeah, like, things that you don't, things you don't think of, you're just like, oh, yeah, I can't do that, because of injuries.
One hand instead of two,
my body won't allow this kind of thing.
Right.
You know?
Stupid body.
But, yeah, thank God I didn't. It didn't hurt me long term.
Yeah. Right.
Where
yeah.
like I would have got spinal like damage or a nerve that would like eventually like cause me paralyzation later on. So I'm just thank God for that stuff like that.
So, as you were watching wrestling growing up, who were some of the people that stood out for you?
Rey Mysterio was the first one. Automatically, I was also a big Edge fan.
Okay.
Like around like the 2007-08 era. Like 2007, 2009 was probably like one of my favorite times in that product, because like there were so many different top guys to pick from. You had like Batista finally came up, Orton became the man, Edge, Cena became the man, JBL, Eddie Guerrero, no, but you still had like so many guys to choose from. Like anybody could be like a main event, yeah. And like you could choose from like a handful of guys literally to be like, we can put them in the main event and they can like carry the ball, mm-hmm. You know, like Mysterio finally became champion around that time. And like, but the two people where I still try to like groom myself off of are like the Mysterios and the Edges, you know, like those are the two, like I try to be like those.
So if you had to describe sort of your in-ring style, what would you say? Would it be high flying or would it be?
I would describe myself as the hybrid. Okay. I don't want to stick to just one category of wrestling because like, I don't want to limit my abilities.
Yeah.
Like I always want to show the fans like all of, like fans never believe that. I'd say CM Punk can't be in any type of match.
Yeah.
You can put him anywhere. Same with the Daniel Bryan. You can put him in any type of match and you know it'll be good. And I always wanted to groom myself like that. Like, you want me to be with high flyers and do like an aerial assault? I can do that. Mm-hmm. I've proven that. You can put me in a ladder match. I can prove, I've done that. I can do that. You can put me against a smashing, heavy-handed Joe Gacy. I can do that. You know, I can wrestle. I want to get on the mat. Like, I want to be well-rounded. I don't want to be like, oh, I'm a 4 in here, but a 5 here, but a 7 here, and then, like, a 9. And, you know, I want to be, yeah. like, a straight level 9 tens and everything.
So, I mean, you've been wrestling for a while now. So when you kind of go around, do you feel like you pick up those things by wrestling other people? Are there specific people that, you know, you wrestled them, you said, you know, I want to incorporate this kind of thing?
Yes, that definitely. Rich Swann was the first guy I really got that from.
Sure.
Because Rich is one of those guys that are just well-rounded in everything. He can wrestle, he can fly, he can hit hard, and he can entertain you at the same time. And that's something that a lot of guys who wrestle the pace that he does, they get so lost in just going this way, this way, this way, this right. way. He stops and settles and just, like, brings the crowd into it. And, like, he's just so good at, like, being so poised and comfortable in the ring and being that guy that everybody wants to come up to and, like, they want him
yeah,
so much. Right. And being in the ring with him, I got to – that rubbed off on me a little bit. And I was like, you know what? I feel – like, because seeing it is one thing, but feeling it is where you actually learn. Right. You actually feel, like, the connection and you feel – like how the pacing and timing and like all like how certain ways of the match go, that's when you feel like you've learned and you got it. Like, okay, I got it now. Mm-hmm. And I feel like Rich Swann was the number one guy. I learned also after that, mm-hmm. but Rich Swann was the first guy that I really got to experience that with.
Yeah. If there was a Shane Strickland it factor, what is that? What is that?
My swerve, baby.
Okay.
And let me explain
that. What is swerve?
Yeah. What is it?
Cheesiest one.
The quickest way I'll get to it is just say, like, I don't like the word swag too much. Like, swag, I was like, everybody thought it was retarded.
Yeah.
And I didn't like it, so I came up with my own. I'm like, swerve? You're swerve. You got swerve, you know? Like, so I always say, like, not my swag. It's my swerve about me. That like the way I walk to the ring, the way, because at the time there was a time where I would be like, come on baby, yeah, come on, yeah. Get come up, yeah, yeah, and like I was like, I felt like needy to the fans, and I didn't want to be like that. Mm-hmm. I want to be the guy that when I walk out, people know who I am. You hear my music, you know what to chant, you know, like when you become that one word type of person, yeah. you kind of are in the fans' heads. now. You kind of are a memory, not an afterthought. Like, oh, that's not Shane Strickland, that's Swerve.
Yeah.
You know? And I like, and I always wanted to do that. Mm-hmm. You know, I always wanted to be that guy. And so when I like come out and I don't want to be needy to the fans. Mm-hmm. I want the fans to want to come to me. I want to be, sure. But I also want to feel unobtainable for them to want to come back and to, for them to like, when they do like say they do get to talk to me or I do get to touch a hand or two, mm-hmm, they'd be like, wow, I finally got to touch them. You know, or like, oh, I didn't get to touch him. I got to come back next month to try to, like, get a handshake from Shane Strickland, you know. But Swerve is, that's my definition of it.
You did touch on it, so I am going to mention it. You have some of the best entrance music ever. How did you make that decision?
Honestly, it wasn't even me that came up with it. It was Aerial Assault that I debuted in, which is the same year that Greg X and Mia Yim had their ladder match, their TLC match. I had no idea what music I wanted to come out to. And Sami Callihan, WWE Solomon Crowe, now, he was riding with Alex Cologne, and he was like, they had the Jackson 5 Best Of album. Why that's in his car, I don't know. I thought he listened to death metal and crows.
It's Michael Jackson.
It's Michael Jackson. It's perfect.
Michael Jackson on everybody's playlist. Yeah, somewhere, yeah. Some way.
On my phone right now, actually.
Yeah.
I have plenty of it on my iPod in my car.
There we go,
so
see?
Everybody has it.
It's American music. Best American music ever. But he's just like, you know what? We were just listening to like the Jackson 5 thing, and we're like, you know what? You should come out. Shane should come out to this, man.
That's a pretty good Sami Callihan too. Like,
I need a DJ. I get around. Like when I hear stuff so much, I mimic.
Yeah.
I'm a parrot. I'm a freaking parrot. Like I hear your voice, I'm a mimic you. But like, but Sami was just like, you know, you should come out to that. You know, everybody's going to expect you to come out to hardcore and hip hop and like something like that. Just go the other way. Go the other way, man. Be that guy. So make fans like you genuinely instead of like trying to do this crazy stuff and try to get them to earn it, you know?
Yeah.
Just like, he's like, I was like, I'm definitely open to that, man. I definitely want to, I'll do that. He's like, cool, I'm going to go talk to DJ right now. And like, goes off and then like next thing you know, I didn't even get to pick which Jackson 5 song it was. Like I didn't, I was like,
do you know which one of them picked it?
I had no idea what it was going to be. I was like, oh, freaking Dancing Machine is going to come on. Now I got to dance. Like I was, and I heard it come on, and then and like all the other guys in the match, it was because it was like eight of us.
Yeah.
Like we're in the match, I was like, is this your music? What music is this? Like, ooh, how's this you? No, I don't know who this is. I like, guess this is me. And so ever since then, it's just been like. Like, oh, Shane Strickland, Jackson 5. And it's cool now because, like, now you know who it is.
Yeah.
As soon as you hear the song, right. You know, like, or when you're at, like, in your, you're in JCPenney and you hear it coming on, like, oh, sorry.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
It's undeniably Shane Strickland. As soon as it hits,
But it's cool. It's funny because, like, fans, like, will message me, like, hey, Shane, like, I heard your song today. I'm like, that's not my song. That's cool that you heard it.
Right.
Like, oh, who
it's
did you...
association.
And it's funny because, like, young fans now don't know who Michael Jackson really is because, like, they didn't grow up with him. You know, he's, like, not their generation. He's ours.
Yeah.
So it's kind of weird that they're like, who did your music? I'm like,
really?
You don't know Jackson 5? You don't know Michael Jackson? Like, it's weird to hear that. So I'm like, somebody like on YouTube, you'll like type in my name, like Shane Strickland, you'll be like Shane Strickland theme. Like, just type in Jackson 5.
Right.
Hear my song. But it's just really funny for me to hear that.
I think one of the things that you do really well is engage with the crowd. And I will say, as a personal point of frustration, sometimes I see guys who are like, I'm going to do everything I can in the ring, which is great.
Right.
But then nobody gets behind them because they don't take that like 5 seconds to go.
Yep.
You know, nothing to feed to the crowd. And I think you do that really well. Do you think that's just something you've picked up? Do you think that, and because I know your background and you said a little bit, you came from Virginia, that there's sometimes more of a crowd that likes a story. Do you think it's that? Like, where do you think that comes from?
I feel like Virginia was like that because they harped on, like, entertainment and crowd interaction so much. And that's how the South is when it comes to professional wrestling. They're like, they don't do as much in the ring because the fans just want to, like, know good guy, bad guy. Like, we want to see the good guy win. It's very, like, sitting on the porch beer can type of fans, you know? And, like, sometimes if you go down there and you'll see, like, a match and it's, like, really complex. It's like a Dean Malenko, Eddie Guerrero-esque, like, technical masterpiece.
Yeah.
And they'll put them in, like, a three-handed credenzal, like arm wrapped, and then like the fans will be like, "Woo, America!" That's the reaction you get. Yeah. You're like, I don't understand, like, but like I got to, but it, that's why I feel like I was really grateful about being brought up down there and then being able to learn and grasp the new style up north, because I was able to take that with me and like wrestle with like Rich Swann and add those type of characteristics, and like wrestle with A.R. Fox, who has those characteristics, and then wrestle like a Joe Gacy, who's hard hitting, and then wrestle like Andrew Everett, who can high fly. So I got to take all these aspects of things and put it into something, and then put make it my own, but find my own little niche about it. So I, if that made me special, I'm so grateful that you people appreciate it. Thank you. I was just doing something that like something I'm comfortable with and that I know. Cause I like there's been times where I try to venture and try to do things that I wasn't comfortable with. Like, oh, let's see how this is. I didn't like that. It didn't work out really well. And then like, but I come back to what's like naturally myself. But it's, it comes from a grasp of all these places, people I've worked with, things I've watched, things I've seen work, things that didn't work. You know, and that's what it comes to watching wrestling. You watch wrestling. And that goes to students, like anybody who's trying to train and learn. You need to watch wrestling as much as you can, all types, like WWE. You need to watch Down South. You need to watch Territorial. You need to watch 80s, 70s, 50s, 60s. See how wrestling has improved. See what they're still using then that we still use now. See what we have evolved from. You know, see fans, how they react this area, how they react this area, how they react to this. All these things come into play. And they all, this all part of learning. And like I've sat down and watched entire 3-disc DVDs, 5-disc DVDs, and matches I didn't like, I sat through them. I'm like, oh, this is really, really hurting. But you know why it's not good now.
Right.
And you, so you don't make those same mistakes, you know?
What's the biggest mistake when you're watching like your own matches, or when you're watching something, you know, it's a bad match? What's the biggest thing that you really kind of pick out every time that you see everybody doing that you think is a mistake?
Crowd interaction, what it comes down to, or compensating, doing too much, you know, to like, oh, I don't think the last match did was insane, so we got to do more.
Right.
No, you don't. Not necessarily. You know, it's like...
not in that way, because...
But like, at the same time, at WrestleMania 17, the TLC match was insane.
Right.
It was insane. Nobody's seen anything like that. With six people, three teams, it was insane. But the crowd still came unglued when Rock and Austin walked out.
Yeah.
You know? So, and that's before they even started wrestling. So, what's more important, the insanity or the connection? You know? And that's what people got to start putting, like, not first, but necessarily being aware of. I have to connect first in order to gain the respect of it. You know, to order to for my 5-star matches to be 5 stars. You know, not necessarily like head drop, head drop, head drop, head drop, head drop, head drop, flip, head drop, you know?
Yeah.
Like, it's all about, like, knowing those things, like, knowing history, like, being able to be like, oh, I can go back to WrestleMania this and watch this match because this is the same situation I'm in now. You know, like, you can pull from those ideas and put them on. But, like, I say, like, the mistake, I made that mistake, too, several times, you know, because I get caught up with wanting to do that, but I'm like, you know what? Nope. I need to stop, relax, come back. And find like who I am, why I got here, what brought me here, being myself, you know.
And I was really impressed earlier when we were talking about Best of the Best in the interview you didn't see.
The last interview.
Where you knew like, well, you know, Trent won and Winger won, and you were like pulling out things from CZW's past. And I think a lot of people who come into CZW don't know that knowledge.
Yeah.
They don't have that sort of base.
It's very true.
Do you think that gives you an advantage?
It does. Knowledge is the best advantage you can ever have. Knowing why a company is here, who built it, who are the staples, why these people were the legends of CZW, why these guys, if you learn from them and watch them, you'll understand why they are those. That's why those guys are either like in bigger places now, or they'll be remembered forever.
Yeah.
Because you know, like you get to, it's a library you get to go back on, and you get to study. Before I even had my first match at CZW, I was like going to the website, looking up the history. DJ had the library, and I was like, well, always wanted to see these guys because I heard so much about them. I want to know who they were. I want to know what they did, why they are who they are. Maybe like I can find something and I can use that and I can get to where they were, you know? And I feel like that's some of that's missing. Like, there's not enough history lessons being taught, you know? Like, you gotta know your history of, like, the guys that came before and built it to where it's at. So maybe you can rebuild it to go to another level that has never been before, you know?
So if someone new were to come in, you know, this year or in 5 years, and they wanted to learn the history of Shane Strickland, what's the match that they should go to start? Where should they start with your history?
Me and Rich Swann, definitely. Me, like,
is there a specific one that stands out in your mind as, like, that was your moment?
The Cage of Death, Cage of Death 14. That was definitely a moment. It was definitely because Swann was that guy. Swann was where I was at that time. I was the new guy coming in, and, oh, there's going to be another... At that time, he was like, oh, there's another Sabian, you know? And at this time, when I came in, oh, I'm another Rich Swann,
yeah,
you know?
Yeah.
And so but Rich Swann got his own identity, and he became Rich Swann, and he wasn't compared to anybody else anymore.
Yeah.
At that time, I was getting my own identity. So now I'm not compared to Rich Swann anymore. You'll never hear that in CZW again because I made my own identity. Sure. And Swann helped me with that. Same way Sabian did that with Swann, you know. And I feel like that was the coming of age deal. Also, like, I feel like the Down with the Sickness ladder match was another coming of age thing for me, you know. Even though I lost both of them, I suck, you know. But you gotta be brought down to build yourself back up.
So before, as we get ready to depart, any last words that you'd like to say?
Oh, I'm going to plug. There plug, you go. Plug away.
I was going to make sure you did it if you didn't
plug,
say it.
I'm going to plug, plug away because I got kids to feed, man. You can always follow me on Twitter at Strickland Shane. Same way with Instagram at Strickland Shane. You can also go online on ProWrestlingTees.com. I have like 3 or 4 shirts. I don't know. They took them down yet. But the different designs to choose from. You can always come to a CZW show and buy one from me yourself. I'll autograph it for you. I'll do whatever you want as long as, you know, you bring your... Yeah.
Yeah.
I get to go to Mexico in May.
Very cool.
So that's amazing. Like, my first... Like, I've wrestled in Canada before, but... I don't really, like, it was a good experience too, so I don't want to downplay that at all. But, like, I feel like Mexico was, like, where, like, once again, where my favorite wrestler of all time started, Rey Mysterio. So, like, wow, I get to go to where he got his big break, you know, so that's amazing. It's just, there's so much more things in the making that I can't really touch on yet until it's, like,
happen.
But if they follow you on Twitter, then they'll get.
If you follow me on Twitter, you'll definitely know, and on Facebook because I'm always on both. I check them like more than I check my freaking heart pulse. You know, like, am I breathing? No. Like, but I know if Twitter is breathing.
Right.
I know if my Facebook is breathing. You know, you can always like, you know, I'm very interactive, as long as you're not being a Josh Williams.
Yeah, yeah.
I'll interact with you.
One day we'll have Swerve Twend. Trend. Swerve Twend?
Swerve Twend.
Yes, a Swerve Twend.
What? Hopefully. Let's do that. Like, try to think if there's anything else that we can touch on. Best of luck to everybody in Best of the Best, you know. It's unfortunate I wasn't able to compete in it this year.
You got this.
But I got this.
You have a shiny belt. I think that stands for
which I will be remembered forever. Hopefully, I'm probably like the, I believe I'm the 8th or 9th person to ever hold this championship.
Wow.
So
it's pretty beat up for something that's only been.
Thank you, A.R. Fox. He probably dove with it.
That's, you know what, yeah, yeah.
He probably did a flip with it and came up, yeah, but, like, just, once again, just, like, I have so much respect for this company. These three letters mean the world to me to finally be able to, like, be considered a CZW alumni now. Mm-hmm. After my career ended tomorrow, I could still be considered a CZW alumni,
right.
And that's the proudest thing I could ever ask for. Because I never, like, being in a backyard, being to like main eventing a Down with the Sickness or being in a Cage of Death is probably one of just like the biggest honors there is, especially in my career and how fast people can just like fade out or just get burnt out. From doing this, I could still continue to love to do it, you know? And I'm not hurt yet. I'm not injured.
Where's that wood?
Where's that
piece of paper?
Processed wood. Processed wood, right. Processed wood, knock on, that I don't get hurt tonight, tomorrow, the next day, the next week, next month, next year. Mm-hmm. I just want to continue to do what I love to do.
Awesome. Well, fans, you can make sure you're checking us out online. Of course, you're watching us on our YouTube channel, which is CZW News.
Perfect.
We have our Twitter feed,
which is at Combat Zone. You can also do the Instagram, which is also at Combat Zone.
As well as the official Facebook site at Official CZW.
Mm-hmm.
So, fans, thank you very much. Thank you, Shane Strickland.
Thank you, guys.
Shane Strickland. Thank you very much.
Can you get your R's right?
Right, Shane Strickland. And this is what's important, so swerve all night.
Don't forget who holds this.
Tim.